This is Gambit from Marvel Heroes, and you are watching the Codec.
Hey, this is Vito Scaletta, and you better be watching the Codec if you know what's good for you.
What's up, ladies and gentlemen? Welcome back to another episode of The Codec. Today's guest is Rick Pascalone. This is an audio dub over for the actual interview as my microphone wasn't working. So with that said, thank you guys so much for tuning in. The first question that I asked
Rick, how you doing, guys?
On here, or the first one that we kind of led into, was just kind of what, who he was, where he was from, that kind of thing. And that's pretty much it, and then I get the microphone situated. So enjoy the rest of the interview, guys. Thank you so much, and we'll see you at the end of the interview.
Pretty good. Feels good to be back and to co-host with you, of course. And we got a great guest on as well today. Yeah, so I guess we're going to start by the roots, Rick. So tell us about yourself, how you got into acting, and how did this all become voice acting at the end?
How did I get into acting? I got into acting because I'm not qualified to do anything else in the world.
Oh.
I started out in New York. I grew up there, and I went to the theater a lot as a kid. My mom used to take me to the theater, and I think that's where I got bitten by the bug. One of the first shows I ever saw was Amadeus on Broadway, and it had a real impact on me. And I think that stuck with me for a long time. And even after I graduated college, I still wasn't convinced that that was what I was going to do. But I went back to New York and started taking classes, and I got into a show called Tony and Tina's Wedding. And I played the groom, Tony, for a couple of years. And that was like the validation that, okay, I think I can do this for a living. And while I was in New York, I started doing voiceover, just not really taking it seriously. And then little by little, it became more and more part of what I did. And I realized that, you know, I had an aptitude for it, and I really enjoy it. So that's how that happened. a lot of happy accidents along the way, and here we are.
Great.
I really had no idea. First of all, I had no idea that Vito would become, you know, such a beloved character. And I really didn't know. I was still fairly new to video games. I had done a few, but I hadn't done, you know, anything on this level. And it was a complete surprise. And, you know, I thought, because in the past it had always been, you go in, you do a job, you do a couple of days, and you're out of there. And that's it, you know. But when they started to cast for three, and 2K had reached out to me and they said, you know, we're really thinking about bringing you back, I was really excited because it's a great character and it's a great group of people to work with.
I think there's, you know, always that that little bit that we hear from a lot of voice actors, that little bit of uncertainty whether, you know, if this character is going to, you know, return again, especially, you know, in some of the older games where it's a lot of one-ofs and, you know, not a lot of sequels. And for you to you know, make an impact like that with, you know, a character like Vito, it definitely says a lot to your character. And then, you know, they bring him back for three. Can you tell us kind of about the process of that? Did they call you specifically? Did you hear about three coming out and then kind of re-audition? How did that go?
Well, it was kind of a different experience even from the get-go. Like, you know, I'm sure you've heard from a lot of other actors, you know, you go in, you audition, you send an audition in. You know, maybe you hear something, maybe you don't. A couple months later, come in, do this job, and then you're out, and, you know, you don't really, you know, hear much more about it. With Vito, I was brought in very early on in the process. The game really hadn't, the script hadn't even been finalized yet.
Oh, cool.
I had a meeting with Jack Scalise, who's in development at 2K, and you know, we just kind of met each other, and I think he was trying to see, like, you know, just trying to see who I was. He think I'm going to be locked up with this guy in a room for weeks and weeks at a time. Yeah. No, I better like him. So, and it turned out we were both from New York. We were about the same age. We had liked a lot of the same things. We loved the same movies. And he started putting me through the paces for just to read different characters and different voices. And we kept going back. I didn't even know anything about, you know, about the game at that point.
Right.
And he kept bringing me back to this one character, Vito. And he goes, yeah, I think I think you might be right for this guy. And I went, yeah, okay.
not knowing this is the one you played that many years ago?
Or no, this is going back to two. I'm giving you the whole back.
Okay, cool.
So this is all, but the script was originally developed by 2K Czech. So the script was written in Czech and then translated by a British gentleman. And that was the script that we were working from, by this very lovely British gentleman who didn't have the first idea how street guys talk. And Jack and I sat in a room for about 2 weeks reading through the script and changing it and making Vito speak like Vito.
Right.
And that's how really the character got so ingrained in me. And when they decided to come back for three, because of the way the production has changed, as you're aware, you know, a lot of it's performance capture now, and a lot of Mafia 3 was done with performance capture.
Very cool.
And they weren't quite sure if I looked enough like Vito that when we did the performance capture that I'd be able to pull it off. And they, thank God, one of the producers, Nicole Sandoval, pulled up a picture of me recently and was like, he really does kind of look like this guy. I think this can work. And because they really weren't sure that they could use me, but luckily they could, and I was able to reprise the role, you know, a few years later, but still very much Vito.
Definitely. So not only did you get to voice act him, you actually play him in motion capture?
Yeah, which was really cool. Really make him live and breathe. Working with Alex Hernandez, who plays Lincoln.
Yeah.
And a lot of just one great, great actor after another.
Yeah, they're starting to bridge that gap between, you know, a video game voice actor and, you know, just a regular actor. They're becoming one and the same thing nowadays. Jen, you have our next question.
So, in between voice acting and doing the motion capture for this character in Mafia, so this game has a lot of graphic violence, adult themes, nudity. So did that concern you, doing kind of like the voice or the motion capture for that? And how was that experience for you?
Well, yeah, I think we set the record for Mafia 2 of the most F-bombs in a game.
Pretty sure.
My mother is very proud. Yeah. the nudity doesn't play a big part because you're locked up inside a skin tight motion capture suit, and other than being, you know, mortally embarrassed, that doesn't have too much effect in it. You know, you're still, at the end of the day, you're playing a role, you know, and I'm not gonna let my kids watch the game or play the game, but you know, but I didn't have a problem with it. I thought, you know, most of what they did, and especially in 3, they're dealing with really kind of advanced themes as far as, you know, racial, racism and you know, what was all happening during that time period. Pretty impressive that they tackled it in this particular game. And I give them a lot of credit for trying to stretch the boundaries of what, you know, of what people are doing these days.
Yeah, definitely. They've definitely been a studio that doesn't shy away from this kind of thing. They've basically, you know, tell the story that they want to tell in an uncensored and unkind of PC kind of way, which is good. I mean, you really need games like that. I mean, we have movies like that that people love and adore, and I don't see any reason why games should get away from it. We're just curious, as a voice actor, we've interviewed a couple on the show that go, you know, I had this one role, but the game was just a little bit too this for me or a little bit too that. So it's good to see that, you know, you're taking it as, you know, the actor role, where you're playing a role and you understand kind of what's going on in the story.
Well, they were very clear, the writers, the production team, you know, were very clear about what they were trying to accomplish. It wasn't gratuitous. I mean, it fits the characters that you play, you know, the dialogue. Right. If something didn't feel right, they were really open to hear why it didn't feel right and how they could, you know, change it or make it work, you know. Gotcha. And we tried to honor what they had written as much as possible. I mean, really word for word, you know, trying to get this story told. And I think everybody was really on board with it.
That's awesome to hear. Let's see here. Our next question. Okay, so you also worked on some of the Godfather series. You've got this kind of you got a little bit of typecasting going on here. You played.
My name ends in a vowel. What do you expect? They're going to throw me in everything. Yeah.
Can you tell us how the mafia storylines and the Godfather storylines, how they differ for you as an actor, and how you kind of handle each one differently, or are they kind of similar at the end of the day?
Well, the similarity, especially between and again, the similarities between, you know, The Godfather and especially Mafia 2 were dealing with family dynamics, you know, the duality of these guys where they have this family life, you know, coupled with their quote family, you know.
Right.
It's always interesting, you know, and sometimes the actual family gets short shrift. People, you know, people are not as interested because they're not, it's not as glamorous, but what it does is it grounds the character in some sort of relatable quality that this guy, he's a son, he's a brother, he's a husband, whatever it is, yeah. It makes them more real and more three-dimensional characters than, you know, just guys that go out and, you know, blow away, you know. 100 bad guys in a minute.
Definitely.
You know, the difference was, you know, The Godfather is one of my favorite movies of all time. You know, and it was a real tragic tale. Vito's tale ended up being not quite as tragic, although in Mafia 3 you kind of see, as you saw in Godfather 2, you see Al Pacino's character falling deeper and deeper into the hole that he dug for himself.
Right.
And not to give too much away, but Mafia 3 does address some of those issues. And you do see what happens to Vito and where he ends up and where he's going to.
Very cool. Jen, you're up.
So you also play a lot of like ambient background side characters. So do you find those easier or maybe harder? Oops, harder than main characters?
You know, everything has its challenges. It's mm-hmm. you know, if you're playing a small role, you have to kind of create your own history for who these guys are. You know, Vito is a character that was I was given so much information about him.
Right.
That it's easy to dig in and find all these nuances. You're playing a smaller character. I like to call them bullet catchers, you know. And sometimes it's just, you're just screaming in pain for the entire game. But you know, I still try to bring some, you know, something unique to each character and create for myself, just so I don't get bored and lose focus. You know, you got to keep reminding yourself who this guy is and what he's all about.
Definitely. So when you're doing, you know, these kind of background or ambient characters, you kind of more or less look at the overarching story of like the game that you're in, or do you try and you know, do like an individual person? How does that work when, you know, they say, okay, you're the, you know, male populace of Chicago?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, oftentimes you don't, you know, you show up for the session. You don't know the scope of the game. Okay. You might not know where you are. Am I on an alien planet? Am I on Earth? You know, you really don't know. It's really up to the director that's running the session to tell you, okay, this is where we are. This is what you're doing. This is who you're talking to.
Right.
Because you only get your lines on a piece of paper, and you're in the blind.
Gotcha.
So. You have to put your trust in the person that's directing you, that they know what they want and they know where it fits in the place of the game, so that, and then you adjust your performance accordingly.
Mm-hmm. It almost seems like it would be harder to do that than, you know, a character that, you know, you've got a backstory on and you know, kind of what he looks like. Maybe you've got like concept art. It seems like that might be a little easier for, as an actor, to kind of jump into and capture, rather than, okay, you're a bunch of random people. So
it definitely helps to have the history of the guy to know what you're playing. You know, and yeah, for the background characters, sometimes it's only you get a little character art, a little sketch of here's a soldier in a uniform. You know, okay. Could be anybody sounding like anything. It's up to me to determine, you know, what works.
All right. Well, this next question comes from a character who definitely has a developed story. You played one of my favorite superheroes, Gambit, in Marvel Heroes. Can you tell me what it was like bringing someone that iconic to life? Did you kind of draw from any past Gambits, and or did you kind of do your own Gambit based on maybe stuff that you had heard, or did you go in completely fresh and just do your own voice?
I tried to do my own thing. I was aware that he was a very, you know, iconic character, but I didn't really want to try to do anything that anybody else had done, because that's, to me, that's a bit of a trap, because you get caught up in trying to just imitate a sound or a voice, and you're no longer playing a character, then you're just playing a disembodied voice, and I don't feel like that. For me, it doesn't work, you know. So again, I had to go in and try to just start fresh, and they seem to like it, and he's a fun character to play, you know, a lot.
So did you, when you're doing a character like, you know, like Gambit, when you're coming up with his accent, you've got a couple different paths that you can kind of take with him. Can you tell us about the process of coming up with Gambit's kind of unique accent? You know, he's got that kind of French quarter, but he's also, you know, almost like a New York-y, New Jersey kind of guy. How was it coming up with the right accent for Gambit?
Well, you know, the New York guy is always inside of me. That follows me wherever I go.
Yeah, right.
That's the attitude. You can't lose that. As far as the you know, his Creole New Orleans background is, I've spent some time in New Orleans, and I just am one of those people that when, if I'm in a place, I try to absorb, you know, put it in the file for some other time. And so the times that I've spent in New Orleans, I've studied people and listened to them and kind of had that in my back pocket waiting to use it. And then Gambit came along.
Okay. Very cool. I think he's one of the most popular characters in Marvel Heroes. A lot of people love playing him, and he's got a bunch of unique dialogue, you know, just kind of to his kind of sassy character. And I got to assume it was a lot of fun playing that role. Can you tell us about the recording process for Gambit? Was it a long thing? Was it a short kind of one day stint?
It was, from what I recall, it was short day, you know, one day here, one day there, for whatever they needed. It's rare that you do more than one session, unless there's a ton of a dialogue, you know, a character, right. You know, like Vito, that, you know, that we were there for, you know, months and months and months, yeah. recording, adding stuff. But usually it's more contained. Okay. And as far as playing him, it was a lot of fun. And they gave me the freedom to you know, get crazy with him and really push the envelope a little bit here and there, and everybody was having fun. Even the guys in the control room were laughing, so that's a good sign.
Definitely. All right, I've got one more question before I switch it over to Jen. Your IMDb page credits you on a major game, Halo 5, but it doesn't say exactly who or what you did there. Can you kind of tell us if you remember recording for Halo 5 and what you may have played? Did you play some soldiers, some background characters, or were you maybe
Spartan? It was a couple, I think it was three different characters, smaller bullet catchers. I'd be hard pressed to remember their name thing, but it was definitely a bunch of different stuff. And again, you know, that was one of those situational games where you show up and they say, okay, you're under fire, you're
Okay.
Breaking into this place, you're here, you're screaming in pain, a lot of screaming in pain.
Yeah, Taylo, I can only assume.
Yeah.
The reason I ask is I'm always curious when you're doing a game like Halo 5 being such a large game as far as monetarily and fan base and all this kind of stuff. Is the recording process any different from a huge game like that to maybe something like Marvel Heroes, which is a kind of smaller in scope game, or is the recording process kind of normally the same?
In my experience, it's been fairly much. It's pretty much the same. There's a handful of studios that here in Los Angeles and New York that, on the inside, they all pretty much look the same, and it's the process is very similar now. Things have changed slightly in the booth. Instead of reading off a script, most of the time we're reading off a video screen, and they throw the dialogue up and, give you again the direction that you're going, and you just cycle through, a couple of thousand lines of dialogue, and all completely out of context from different parts of the game, and they cut them and paste them in wherever they need them as. So it can be a little all over the place, and you don't necessarily know, where it happens in the game. But it's like doing a movie. You shoot out a sequence a lot, so you kind of have to be prepared for anything.
All right, Jen, you've got the next two questions.
All right. So in Mafia 3, I guess we'll jump back on that subject. Your character's coming back. Spoiling anything, could you tell us maybe what we could expect from Vito or what's kind of going on in that?
Yeah, let me see what I can say. My NDA hanging over my head. Well, what we can say, it does take place about 15 years after the end of Mafia 2. And Vito has relocated to New Bordeaux, where the game takes place. And he's been kind of double-crossed and beaten down by life. It didn't exactly go the way he thought things were going to go. And he's still Vito. He's still trying to get back. He wants to be back on top again. He's older, but he hasn't given up, and he earns the respect of Lincoln and some of the other characters in the game, the other spokes characters they call them. It was a challenge because from going from being the alpha dog to one of the puppies, it was a big hit for his ego, but it fuels it in a way, and it changed the character slightly so that it gave me something to play off of and something new and fresh. So it wasn't just going back and playing the same character in the same way. So that was kind of cool.
Definitely. Jen, before you hit your next question, I've got to tell you, Rick, there's a lot of there's a very tight-knit community around Mafia. It might not be the biggest one out there, but the people that love it are really passionate about it. And there's actually a theory going around, and I promised a couple of the guys on that were asking me to ask you on YouTube that I would let you kind of know that there's a fan theory going around that maybe Vito doesn't have kind of the best intentions, and maybe he's playing kind of sly and using the new character to kind of rise up, and then he's going to try and take him out at the end. What do you think about a theory like that? Do you think it's in Vito's character to do something like
Hey, anything's possible.
that? Definitely. Jen, your next question.
I guess this is more of a personal, interesting question, but if there would be one character from your childhood that you could voice, or who could you play? Who would it be?
Yosemite Sam.
really?
No, I don't know. I grew up on Saturday morning cartoons. I mean, it was Yosemite Sam, Bugs Bunny, the Road Runner, Wile E. Coyote. I mean, that
Yes,
was,
Sam.
yeah. I mean, that's anybody that does voiceover that's over 20. That's what we grew up on. That's what we were glued to the TV watching before there were video games, before anything like that. It would be so much fun to play, an animated character like that. But I mean, Yosemite Sam's, I'm being silly, but But that's what, you know, that's what we all draw from, you know, those classics, those classic Saturday morning cartoons. And, you know, at the end of the day, we're all just playing in the sandbox. You know, this is, it's the greatest job ever. Anybody who says different, why?
Yeah, I can only assume, you know, getting to bring obviously iconic characters like Gambit to life, and then kind of breeding your own character, just like, you know, like Vito and some of the other ones that you've played here in the past. I gotta imagine it's just a fun thing, especially if you're passionate about characters. You know what I mean? I think doing the voiceovers, I think you're our 68th or 69th voice actor that we've interviewed, and that's something that we hear repeatedly. Is everybody loves doing it, and that's great to hear.
There is a certain freedom that you don't get. I mean, you know, you're doing on camera stuff. I still do. You know,
yeah, you're in a lot of movies TV stuff
and things like that, but you know, and that's great. It's I love it. I still do live theater as well, and there's nothing like live theater with an audience, you know, there. It's great. But doing animation, doing video games, there really is a freedom. I mean, you could do anything. You could be anything. You're not limited to how you look.
Right.
You're limited to only the limits of your imagination. And you know, it's a great, it's one of the most fun things, unless of course you happen to be, you know, dying repeatedly, screaming for your life at the end of the day.
So you got to do those so you can get the big roles. You know, you get that one death scream can bring you up into a full played out character. We're getting towards the end of the interview here, Rick. You've been awesome. I gotta say, my mom was really jealous when I told her I was interviewing you because she loves Young and the Restless. Our last question for you before we get into our outro that we talked about earlier is, are there any kind of upcoming projects besides Mafia that people might be interested to know that you're in? Any kind of TV shows, plays, movies, video games in the pipeline for you?
Yeah, I think people are going to enjoy, there's a show, Transformers, Robots in Disguise, and I am going to be playing a couple of characters in the upcoming season. It's a really fun show. The scripts are really, really funny. And
we know one of the main characters. I don't know if maybe you guys did a voice session together, because I know cartoons usually do, you know, the whole cast, and they're Paul Eiding. Did you get to work with him at all?
Yeah.
Yeah. Paul's a good friend of the show. He's been on here a couple of times for our charity events and stuff, so I think he'll be excited to see we got another Transformer guy in here.
Yeah, it's a really great show, and they're just started airing season two. I am in the following season, which should be coming up fairly soon, but hopefully we'll be doing more of those as well.
Definitely. So you've got the Transformers. Any video games in the pipeline that you can talk about, or is everything kind of hush-hush right now?
Yeah, unfortunately, everything is a little hush-hush at this point. But when I can, I will be sending it out to the on social media that you can look out for me. Okay. I'll be sure to let you guys know as well.
Well, yeah, definitely. We'll more than likely invite you back on the show after Mafia 2 or 3 has been released. And it's had some time to play. Maybe in a couple months, we'll let you back on the show for maybe a quick update or something like that, just to can talk a little more about what's going on. Yeah, October 7th. So about one and a half more weeks or so, and then we'll finally get to see what goes down in Mafia 3, which we're all excited about. Jen,
it's gonna be really great. I mean, I haven't even seen everything, but from right. what I have, the graphics are amazing. The story's great. I mean, the acting is top notch. And I want to say personally, like, I appreciate everybody that plays the game, and I get so much love back for Vito. And I just want to say I really appreciate it.
Oh yeah, definitely, man. I think there's always that dynamic. Like I said earlier, if you nail a character, whether he's a side character or a main character, people can really latch on to that. And you know, you bring that mafioso vibe with you when you kind of go into the booth, and I think everybody just likes that. And not to down any of the Godfather games or anything that you've done in the Godfather, but Mafia always has seemed a little bit more believable to me, just because I think maybe it's not attached to the movie franchise. So,
well, we were also really going for, and again, and this goes back, you know, to two, we really tried to bring as much reality to you know, put characters in real jeopardy and have a real sense of loss or victory. And, you know, and it's, you know, they were constantly tinkering with the stakes. You know, what are the stakes in this scene? What do we have to gain? What do we have to lose? Characters and conflict always, you know, it's always exciting when you can bring that to even the smallest scene, the smallest exchange, if there's something at stake. And I think that made the difference for a lot of people.
Awesome. Jen, any other questions for Rick before we let him get out of here?
I just had one more. Sorry, I know we're a little bit over 30 minutes. I just thought of this one, but you worked with a lot of voice actors that we've had actually on the show, like Steve Downes, like at least, I don't know, with him with Halo 5 and then some other ones with Transformers. But is there like maybe one or two people that have really like inspired you, impressed you, or maybe influenced you in the voice acting career?
Well, I mean, I've also crossed paths with Nolan North, who I'm sure you know, the very prolific Nolan North.
He's in every video game ever.
He's in every video game ever. Yeah.
Him and Troy Baker.
But Nolan especially, what I appreciate about him, firstly, he's super talented and he deserves everything he gets. But he's also a really nice guy. Like just, you know, hanging out in the lobby, having a cup of coffee, you know, just a good guy. And I have to say, it is a very small community. There's a handful of guys and gals that work all the time. And I think part of the reason is, as I said earlier, you have to be stuck in a room with these people for sometimes weeks, months on end. And, you know, you got to play nice in the sandbox. And, you know, it goes back, it's kindergarten all over again, you know, right? Share your toys, man, you know. I worked on Mafia 3. I worked with a great actor named Jay Acovone, who also I've known for a long, long time. And he's a marvelous actor. He's got a great voice. He plays Sal Marcano. And I think you're going to love his performance because he does something really special with it.
Awesome.
That's great.
Well, we're definitely looking forward to that. Rick, before we let you get out of here, we got the two lines to have you read for us, and then we'll let you go. So I'm going to post them to you in Skype here. That way you can just read them out. That is the first one. And
let me see here.
Is the second.
This is Gambit from Marvel Heroes, and you are watching The Codec.
Hey, this is Vito Scaletta, and you better be watching The Codec if you know what's good for you.
That was awesome.
That's awesome.
I loved it. Two, I picked these two because they've got similar tones, but they're very different characters, and I think the fans will love that. Rick, thanks you so much for coming here, man. We really appreciate it. Before you leave, can you tell everybody where to keep up with you, your social media? Obviously, we have your Twitter listed right below here, but do you have a website or a Facebook or anything like that where people can keep up on what you're doing?
Yeah, you can go to rickpasqualone.com, and also, like you said, if you go on IMDb, under my name, Rick Pasqualone, you can see all the new stuff that I've been doing. A new show coming on the air called Guidance, where I'm doing a couple episodes. You can see that at Awesomeness TV. And everything else at Ricky P66. I'll be letting you all know what's happening next.
Awesome. Jen, you want to say bye to Rick?
Yeah, I mean, thanks, Rick, for coming on. It's been a pleasure, and the voice was awesome at the end. And thanks for having me on The Codec and friends, and catch me soon. And thanks for having me on again.
Definitely. Thanks, all right, Rick. Have a good day, sir. Bye.
Thank you.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, that was our show. Thank you so much for watching this episode of The Codec. Thank you, Jen, for returning for an episode. I hope you had some fun here. Do you want to say bye to our viewers before we get out of here?
Bye, and I'll be back soon, hopefully.
Tell them where they can follow you, keep up to date on what you're doing.
That's a good idea. Well, I'm just doing casting and hopefully going to continue interviewing these voice actors, but you can follow me on Twitter at @LemonKiwi_, Instagram, @LemonKiwi_, and that's pretty much it. And I'll catch you guys around.
Awesome. Thanks, Jen.
Bye.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, that concludes our show for today. Thank you so much for watching this episode of The Codec. I definitely want to apologize to everybody for all of the ridiculous technical difficulties, as you can see, we have going on here. We did not have our proper recording software set up. And it was just way too late for me to learn how to use a brand new one. So I just had to improvise with OBS and it looked like absolute shit. So I definitely want to apologize to you guys for that. I feel super bad about all of that technical difficulties, but I'm glad you guys stuck with us. I'm glad you guys enjoyed the show. Couple things here. We are doing another voice actor interview next week, so make sure you tune in next Friday for the Codec. We also have Warfare Weekends returning this weekend with Arma 3 on Sunday. In addition to that, we have a new show Wednesday morning at 9 o'clock. It's called The Live View. It's where you can check out brand new games live streamed and reviewed live here on Hitbox.tv. So make sure you give Hitbox some love and give us a follow. Check out some of the other streamers over here on Hitbox. And lastly, it is the last couple days for our signed print giveaway. Donations of $40 get you one signed print from any voice actor we've had on the show, with the exception of Troy Baker and James Horan. Any voice actor that we've had up to this point is eligible to sign a print for you for your character. $40 gets you one, $50 gets you two, $60 gets you three, so on and so forth, and you can get as many as you want. Just be aware that the more you get, the more time it will take, because they've got to be shipped here, signed, shipped back, so on and so forth. So it takes a little bit longer the more you get. But if you're interested in having a signed print from one of your favorite characters that we've had on the Codec, make sure you jump on that train, as we are closing out the donation window on that, and the voice actors will no longer be doing it at the end of this month. So make sure you get that in before the end of the month. That way everything can be shipped prior to. With that said, make sure you go give Jen some love on Twitter. Give her a follow, and go give my other two co-hosts who couldn't be here today, unfortunately, go show those guys some love. They're here all the time, and they really go out of their way to make the Codec a good show. That's Corrupt Ronin, at Corrupt Ronin on Twitter, and at Yong Yeah on Twitter. And then obviously, those of you who already know Yong, you can check him out on YouTube as well. But yeah, go check out the co-hosts of the Codec. They make this show go round. And thank you guys again so much for watching. We'll see you next week on the Codec.